sure, I'm going to a writer's conference. I actually went to this conference last year and I did a video and I was like rewatching it last night and it's so cringy. Oh my God. You can tell that was one of the first videos I made on my channel. Oh God, I can't. But anyways, I'm going again this year and I always love coming every year. This is my third year attending and I just love this conference. A bunch of authors come together and also journalists and TV writers and they teach us how to write better and they give us tips and there's also writing workshops. It's just all of the writing things. And there's also book signings because there's a lot of authors who come. So yeah, I'm excited. And then also, would you like to introduce yourself and your channel?
Hi, I'm Yvonne, and my channel is Yvonne Stands, and I'm here because I like to write, and I like reading, and yeah.
And Disney.
And Disney, obviously.
She's like the biggest Disney fan I know.
Because obviously.
I mean, the car ride is like so long, so we're gonna be lip syncing to Disney, because what else are we gonna do to pass the time, you know? I'm not gonna stop fasting.
I drew her mask.
It looks so realistic.
If story and truth are so important, what holds us back? Oh, let me count the ways that fear creeps into a writer's soul. The blank pages. The endless blank pages. They're like something out of an Alfred Hitchcock film. Square white birds pecking and pecking at you. And then there's the clock. It's not ticking, it's screaming at you. You have no time, you have no time. And this white rabbit is stomping on your head. Well, those are writer's nightmares, the kind that never go away. But of course, preeminent among this is our fear of failure. Sharing our work with the world is a thrilling prospect. But at the same time, it's terrifying. It leaves us vulnerable, exposed, naked. We are out there for everyone to see in the most singular, obvious way. It's very much akin to public speaking, which is the number one fear of most Americans. And I think sometimes the things we love the most are the things we fear at failing at the most. Lao Tzu, a Chinese philosopher, said, "Failure is the foundation of success." Gosh, I wish I had heard that when I was your age. And that sentiment is echoed over and over again by countless people we hold up as symbols of great success. The problem is, very often we only see their success and we don't see all the failures that got them there. Thomas Edison failed 10,000 times before he finally got that one light bulb that worked. And with that one success, he changed the world. And that is what we remember, the success, not his long path to get there. By the time I reached high school, I was devouring books, and the hunger in me to be a writer grew. But I had no idea what kind of writer I wanted to be. I was an indiscriminate reader. I would read anything. I read magazines from Tiger Beat to National Geographic. I read encyclopedias like they were novels. I read novels, historicals, romances, science fiction. I love Pride and Prejudice, The Hobbit, 17th Summer, Fahrenheit 451, A Tree Grows in Brooklyn, The Good Earth, anything by Hemingway, and poetry by the buckets. But it wasn't until I pulled a book from the shelf in my high school library and read it that I cried and knew what kind of books I wanted to write. It wasn't a classic. It had never been assigned in a classroom. It wasn't even well known. But it changed my world profoundly. It was a book that was populated with people I recognized, teenagers. And it didn't shy away from the uglier and real side of life. It had truths in it that I saw every day: poverty, prejudice, inequity, violence, and injustice. It was written in a language that I could understand and relate to. It sounded like my world. And it was a book written for me, not for my parents or my grandparents. That book was The Outsiders by Essie Hinton. I read it multiple times, and I cried every time I read it. But I did finally muster the courage to confide this one long-held dream to one of my English professors. I told him I wanted to be a writer. His response was my worst nightmare. He shook his head and said, "All I would ever be with an English degree was a teacher, period." I felt dismissed, chastised for having such lofty thoughts, and embarrassed for having voiced them. His words hit me hard. It may not have been his intention, but all I heard was, "You? You'll never be a writer." My fear at failing at something I deeply loved had been voiced. It's the Society of Children's Book Writers and Illustrators. And I went to their conference. It was my first ever writing conference, and I was a complete deer in the headlights. There were hundreds of writers and would-be writers there. But I found that writers can be very kind and very encouraging. And I had my very first real manuscript critique for this second novel that I had written. And I listened very carefully to the advice, and then I went home and I revised accordingly. I ended up selling that second manuscript 5 months later. I remember being numb, hanging up the phone after the call, and then crying and screaming and dancing in circles in the kitchen with my daughters. It was, and it will always be, one of my sweetest memories. I have 10 published novels now in 20 languages around the world. My books have won awards and been on numerous best-selling lists, and one of them has been optioned for a movie. I have traveled and spoken to thousands of readers and signed just as many books, and I recently sold 2 more on proposal. Oh, and my parents know I'm a writer now. But in the midst of all those successes, there were still plenty of failures and some tears. That first manuscript was never published and will never be published. Was writing it a waste of time? Absolutely not. It was a vital stepping stone. Without it, I never would have been published. It taught me things. I not only learned a heck of a lot about craft, I learned some things about disappointments, setbacks, and myself. I learned that I was a writer. I could write again, and I would write again, because that's what writers do. They write. Well, they procrastinate too, but mostly they write. And they don't give up. Ernest Hemingway said, "We are all apprentices in a craft where no one ever becomes a master," which means it never becomes effortless and easy, though we all wish it would. The only difference between a published writer and an unpublished writer is persistence. It's taken me a while, but I've learned that some of those curveballs, setbacks, birdwalks I took away from my idyllic story actually helped me to become a writer. Like those dramatic, wacky relatives, well, without a doubt, they developed my observational skills at a very early age, and they'd have given me material. So embrace the weirdness in your life. Don't run from it. And what about that art degree I used for all of a nanosecond? It's turned out to be invaluable to me as a writer on so many levels. Newbery Award-winning author Karen Hess noted, our characters come alive when we give them air to breathe and a floor to walk on. Those words have always stuck with me in regard to setting. My art experience helped me to visualize worlds, which in turn gives my characters a floor to walk on. But maybe the greatest thing my art degree gave me was a philosophy about art, all kinds, including books. It makes me look at every book like a painting. I may not understand or appreciate every one, but that does not take away its value or its contribution to art. Every piece of art doesn't have to speak to every person. Its value is there even if it's for an audience of one. And that brings me full circle, sharing truths. Writing is not about being on bestseller lists or winning awards. Yes, those things help me to keep writing, but they are not what feed my soul. I get letters from readers almost every day. They share things with me that humble me. They find connections with my characters. They see the truths of their own life between the pages. They have felt a character's fears and heartaches. They tell me how a character made them feel less alone. They recognize pieces of themselves, truths. And while the story may make them feel less alone, their letters do the same for me. They close the vacuum. We don't just read to know that we're not alone. We write for the same reason. I can't share the whole letter because the details were too specific, but a teen wrote to me saying she and her mom had been estranged for years after her parents had divorced. And while reading The Adoration of Jenna Fox, a book I wrote a number of years ago about a family going through a traumatic event, she said she saw the rocky relationship between Jenna and her mother, Claire, and saw that the pain was not all Jenna's, but Claire's too. She said that it gave her the courage to reach out to her mother, breaking a long silence between them. And she said, we both cried for a long time, and I realized she still loved me, even after I had pushed her away. Thank you for this book. It helped me to reconnect with my mother. Of course, I sobbed as I read her letter. If she had been my audience of one, it would have made writing the book worth it. That's what story does. Our small circle of experience intersects with someone else's. And with that connection, our world is suddenly smaller and we are larger. But through it all, the setbacks and the successes and the tear-jerking letters, it still always comes back to one simple thing. Me, the blank page, the whisper of the story, and showing up. Each of you has your own journey. It won't be like mine or the person sitting next to you. Your untold stories will be shaped and molded by your own curveballs, setbacks, world events, and the twists in your life that you'll continue to have and that will make you the person and the writer that's uniquely you. Not a single other person in this room can fill your shoes. You have stories to tell that no one else can, as long as you show up. So now, I challenge you, go forth, hone your craft, learn, grow, become a warrior of truth, learn to dig deep, slay us with your honesty, be wicked, be ruthless, cut to the core, make your truths cold and hard and hot and sticky and loud so they are impossible to ignore or deny, so they will make us breathless, make us weep, make us angry, make us fall to our knees with gratitude that we are not alone. Whether you are writing a dark drama, a sweeping fantasy, a poem, or a knee-slapping comedy, remind us with every word what it means to be human and what we share. The world needs your voice. Your stories matter. I was a girl who had a calling. So do you. I'm waiting to hear your stories. Be fearless. Thank you.
So the keynote just ended with Mary and Pearson.
And oh my god, my normal Saturday is normally I stay inside all day.
And I started crying. I loved it so much.
What about you? What did you think? I thought it was really nice how, like, I thought it was good how she started.
Yes.
And, like, how she got inspired a little bit. How she didn't give up.
And so what did I do? Of course, I called my friends. When my kids got home later that night, I said I had a terrible day. Be really nice to me. And, you know, I've got ninth grade twins. They're not typically nice to me unless I actually ask them to be. So, and they didn't say like, oh, what happened, Mom? I had to tell them, you know, the book I've been writing, my agent didn't love it, and their response was, huh. So that's why you need writer friends. My children are not writers. My writer friends were wonderful. One of my friends talked to me for half an hour, and then as soon as we were on the phone, he texted me. He said, agents are idiots. 5 exclamation points. That brings me to my first trick of the trade, which is don't use exclamation points.
And a lot of gentlemen at Comic-Con San Diego were very, very upset because the girls had come to watch Twilight. They had come, you know, the Twihards were there, you know, and they were very upset because they were like, well, that's for girls. It's not real geeks. It's for girls, right? We're still at that moment where we're having this kind of problems. So we got to work on that. That's why we're here. That's why we're working.
Woods, those were really ghetto little trees way back in the day. Now they're a little cooler than that. So create a map. So find a recorder and jot down ideas while you run. That was my thing. So I used to live in Oregon, and I would walk around with a recorder. I probably looked like a crazy man at like 2 or 3 a.m., my hair all wild and probably still in pajamas, and I'm like walking around with a recorder, just talking into it around my neighborhood. Still sounds crazy, but I would create these. And I would ruminate, and the best part about the recorder is I would never, ever listen to it again. It was just to get the idea spinning. They call this thing called rubber ducky coding. I don't know if everyone's ever heard of that. But the idea is that if you're doing coding, you're doing HTML, and you run into a block, what you do is you put a little rubber ducky in front of your computer, and you explain to the rubber ducky what the coding is. You're like, hey, so this is supposed to work. And nine times out of 10, that's a random statistic I just used, but a lot of times, you will find out the error, the problem. And the reason why is you explain it and you break it down. It's almost like going back and tracing your steps to find your wallet again. No one wants to do that. Everyone wants to be like, I looked under the cushion 17 times. Why is it not there this time? You know, but if you step back and you trace it and you break it down, then you will kind of find out new things. So the recorder is a great way just to kind of get your memory jogged and moving. You know, no triathlete just jumps in the first day and is like, I'm going to do a triathlon tomorrow. And he signs up today and he goes tomorrow. By world building, it's going to be just flexing your muscle. It's going to be creating these brainstorming. It's going to be creating this world. It's going to be jogging your ideas and creating and writing. And you ever had that where you like are just like, okay, I have to come up with a really good idea now. I don't know. Oh God, you know. Same thing with sitting in front of the computer. You're like, I have to write the best next book, and then you're like, I'm gonna go do my dishes, or I'm gonna go fold my laundry, or play a video game. So by getting your mind spinning, you get excited to sit in front of the computer, and you don't think about it. You're going for a run. You're creating these ideas. You're creating characters and connections. And next thing you know, you're sitting in front of the computer. And you're writing.
So what is up with the freaking fire alarm? This happens every year. Turn off. I'm trying to vlog here.
Yes, like this, we're trying to do this thing here.
Now lunchtime, and I've gone through 2 more panels since the Mary E. Pearson one, and it's been so great. How about you? How's it going?
It's been really great, to be honest.
The first one I went to was with Hayley Jane Cult something. I'll put her name. Anyways, hers was really informative. I think it was like everything you need to know about writing. that you never wanted to ask about. Like, it was really informative, and I really liked that.
Me too.
And then the second one I went to was with Cecil Calvin. Oh my god, that workshop was amazing. I loved it so much. And it was about feminism. It was about feminism in books and movies and trying to combat all the sexism and stereotypes. And oh my god, that is like what I live for. All of those things, feminism is so important to me, and I loved that she talked about that. Let's sit down. Yeah. We got a bench. That's how cool we are.
Like, for the second session, I went to giving your characters a unique voice, which my favorite thing about writing is making character, because it's my favorite thing ever, and I learned so much. I guess something I already knew, but like, it's like rephrasing it to something that can actually stick in my head. You know, like, it just stays there. You don't forget it. It was really good. I liked it.
That's good.
Yeah.
And then I went to the Matt Wolf one, which he talked about grand world building. And world building is so important to whatever genre you write. Obviously, he's a fantasy writer, so his advice was kind of catered to fantasy, but I really liked it. He had this like huge elaborate display, which you might have seen a few seconds ago. It was really awesome, and then that book was hilarious. I love it. I really need to read this book now. It's currently lunch, and it's about to start up in about 10 or so minutes.
Yeah.
And during lunch is the book signing. I got Beauty of Darkness signed by Mary E. Pearson. You know what? What the heck? What? Anyways, and I love talking to Mary again. I really love her. I went to one of her signings a few months ago, and she actually remembered me. I was like, hey, I love seeing you again. And she's like, I love seeing you again. What? Oh, the freaking firefighter showed up.
I told you that one was being important. I asked you.
Wait, is that when everybody was like, what happening?
Yeah.
Live footage. I didn't even notice. Oh my god, the freaking fire truck.
Oh my god, on news.
On news. I was so into talking about books. I didn't even notice the fire truck in the background. But anyways, I love talking to Mary. She's so sweet. And it was honestly like, it made me cry. I loved it so much. She was like, I can't wait to see you at any other conventions. I see you everywhere. I'm like, I know, right? I try to go to every convention, event, everything. I love going to book events. Like, nothing makes me happier than being around bookish people and talking to my favorite authors. And then I talked to Cecile. Even though I didn't get anything signed by her, I really wanted to talk to her because her workshop just like meant so much to me. And I told her that, and she's like, oh my god, I'm so happy because that was the first time I ever did that panel. I'm happy you enjoyed it.
Bonjour! So it's a week after the conference, and I wanted to do a bit of a reflection on it. So after that last clip, there were two sessions and then a concluding speaker at the end. I didn't get any of that because I actually left early. After Greg Van Ecott's session, I stayed for a little bit of the last session and I left early because I was exhausted. I was about to pass out because the night before I didn't sleep much and I had to get up really early to go to the conference and drive an hour. It just took its toll on me and I had to leave early. But actually, one fun thing that happened during Greg's panel is that the fire alarm went off again. And they, like, this one guy ran in and was like, oh, actually, you guys need to evacuate the building. And all of us were like, what? Is there an actual fire then? Crap. Then all of us evacuate the building. And then Greg was like, hey, I don't know about you guys, but do you want me to just continue my workshop? And everyone's like, yeah. So he stood in the middle and then everybody formed a circle around him and he continued. It was really awesome. And the firefighter showed up again. Like, seriously, they showed up twice in one day. Like, it was ridiculous. Like, this school has a really faulty fire alarm. Like, they better get it fixed. And then somebody who goes to that school that was in the circle was like, yeah, this happens all the time. The firefighters show up pretty much every day because our fire alarm is really messed up. Seriously, then fix it, because every year I've gone to the conference, this is my third year, the fire alarm has gone off at random. So I think it's about time they fixed it, you know? Really quick, I want to go over what I got. Oh my god, I got this sticker. Look, it's like Hamilton. It makes me so happy because Hamilton Education is one of the sponsors of the conference. So they gave us this sticker and it pretty much looks like the Broadway musical. Oh my god, it makes me so happy. I love this. And then they also gave us a pen, a Hamilton pen. And then I also got a bookmark from Cecil Castellucci's workshop. And then I only got one book signed, as I mentioned previously, by Mary E. Pearson. She signed it and wrote, "Keep writing." And oh my god, she actually personalized it for me. Like, usually authors, they just pick like a random phrase that has to do with the book and they signed all of the books, the copies of that book that way. But no, she actually signed a personal message to me. Oh my god. I can't even express how amazing it was talking to Mary. Like, it's one thing to be excited and happy to be meeting an author, but it's another thing for them to be excited and happy to be meeting you. Like, I went up to talk to her and she was like, "Oh my god, it's so great to see you again." And I was like, I was like, I don't know if you recognize me. She's like, "No, it was so great to see you again." And then when she walked in for the first time, she saw me and she smiled at me and said hi. And I was just like, oh my god, an author knows who I am. Oh my god, this is insane. I can't even express how amazing that was. And when I told her how much her keynote meant to me and how in her keynote she kept saying, "Never give up on your writing, never stop writing." And I told her that I had almost given up on writing because I've been wanting to write my whole life, but I've always let my writing fears and insecurities hold me back. And she said, "No, keep writing, never give up." And she wrote that in my book. And just, I can't. I love her so much. I can't wait to continue the rest of the series. This is the last book in the it's a trilogy. Boy, is it big. This is a brick. I could kill someone with this. I'm so excited to read this and the second book in the series. I had the most amazing time at this writer's conference. It was really hard to top last year because Susan Dennard, Kirsten White, and Suzanne Young came last year. And Kirsten White and Susan Dennard are like some of my all-time favorite authors ever. So it was really hard to top last year, but I think they did it. It was such an amazing time. That's all for this video. I hope you enjoyed. Comment down below what you thought of this video. And my social media links are all down below. My Twitter, my Bookstagram, my Goodreads. Au revoir! I'm not going to do that.